Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm John Gray, and we're just plain living here.
Good morning, John.
And proud to be plain living.
Proud to be plain living. There you go. I'm Peggy Burton.
And I'm Jim Fuller.
And we're all right proud to be here.
We always are. Yes.
After what happened last week in this town, I mean, it was. We're very fortunate that there was no loss of life.
Yeah, a lot exactly. of things have happened since last week.
We were here. Gosh, you know, so fires you know, and everything. It's just been horrendous. And I heard the high school was on fire yesterday.
It was
last night. What was that about?
It was a heat and air conditioning unit that caught on fire. And just from normal use kind of thing.
Yeah,
and
did it do any damage?
Just to one room. It could have been a serious thing, but, you know, actually the fire department was quick to get on the job.
Well, we have a great fire department and
police and first responders and emergency and you know, what Lane Curley said it well the other night at the South Jackson Civic Center. Tree lighting for the Christmas parade. Of course, we've had the Christmas parade since we were here. Was that the volunteer spirit in this town is just incredible?
It is incredible.
You know, there were young men, married, single, whatever, that had time and put their name out on Facebook. You know, here's how to get in touch with me. I have a chainsaw. I'll come to your house and
That's
help
beautiful.
You clean up.
Right.
And, you know, it's just a wonderful
that
thing.
Doesn't and that doesn't happen in every. No.
You know, and this little deal last night at the high school, and, you know, they're so well coordinated because Tullahoma got there early and assessed the situation, began to try to extinguish the flames, but realizing what it could develop into, they called a unit from Manchester to come in for backup,
that was
wise. And also from Arnold Center, and,
right.
you know, so that, you know, the fire department, if there were other fires, they could continue to function, and so.
Yeah, they and our surrounding communities. I mean, we've had people power crews from Shelbyville and Manchester and Winchester over
even
here
Chattanooga.
Helping.
I think
Chattanooga.
Yeah.
You know, so it's just it's wonderful when people have that kind of spirit, and that's the USA.
You know, it's still that barn raising.
Yeah.
Mentality.
Yeah. Yeah.
I lived on a farm, and if somebody needed a barn, well, all the neighbors came in, they put up their barn, or if they had the roof blow off, they were all there to help.
And we're not waiting on somebody from the government to deal with it.
Yeah.
We're taking care of it ourselves.
Exactly.
Which is what needs to happen,
needs
and
to
know
happen.
Who your neighbors are and help them when they need help. And we've had plenty to be helped with.
You know, I feel blessed to be a Tennessean.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm,
I
sure.
really do.
Volunteer state.
Volunteer
That's
state.
Why they call us that.
And I've heard very little whining during all this. You know, most people just buck up and.
Yeah.
I think that's pretty, what John just said a moment ago, that's pretty neat that young men were putting out there.
I do. I think
you know, I've got a saw. I'll be happy.
I got a day off today.
Yeah.
Need help?
Yeah.
Call me.
Yeah.
Text me.
Yeah.
Which is really better than just rushing 50 people with their chainsaws to one place. It, you know, they get to where they are needed. That's a great idea.
Yeah. So now the wind is gone, but you need a boat.
Yeah.
All right.
Because the rain has come.
My roads are pretty, you know,
all
the water
ditches
is right
are full.
Up to that's right. The
ditches
water is right up to the roadway.
And we had been, 2.5 months without any significant rain, and then all of a sudden.
I know, then all of a sudden we're soaked. Thank goodness.
Yeah.
I live within a lot of trees and a lot of leaves, and it was so dry that spark and it's everything's going.
Yeah.
So smokers need to be very careful.
Yeah.
Have you written
after the other night? I wrote this. That must be a big old train. Can't see to drive for sideways rain. Trees on the ground, power off all over town. God's dropped a bomb. Reminds me of Vietnam. I can't get home. Better get low. Tornado.
That's cool.
You know, so that was my little.
Did you write that before or after?
Well, it was after. You know, you don't expect that.
I was asleep on the floor in the middle bathroom.
In
my
the
house.
Floor?
Yeah,
were
I
you?
Was. Yeah, I just.
And that's good. That's a good place to be.
It's the only place I know to be at my house. So, and I slept right through it.
Yeah.
Because when I woke up, it was midnight, and I thought, okay, I'll just take a look outside.
Yeah.
And see if I have trees. And luckily, it was okay in my area.
So it didn't blow any trees down in your area?
Didn't even turn over you know,
but out your
chair.
Way, but out your way, sometimes you've had stuff
sometimes,
come through right down there by
yeah.
Twin
comes
Oaks Grove.
There,
well, not
yeah.
Twin Oaks, but
sort of in that area.
In that area.
Yeah,
out there
yeah what was it, 3 or 4 years ago? That yeah. was pretty bad when we went through
yeah,
there.
Real so. Bad.
Right
yeah.
up through there.
I was driving home in it,
mm-hmm.
and could, I was on the back road, and there was no such thing as pulling off because, you know, the back road coming from Winchester. Anyway,
there is no pull
and my
off.
Car was just blowing back and forth, and all I did was just keep driving slow.
There you go.
And I was very lucky. Life.
You need to stay off those back roads.
I know.
Peggy.
I know. But that's where I live.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I live in
yeah.
there.
So,
a while ago when I said, I'm proud to be here, it reminded me that Madame Tussauds is building a museum in Nashville.
Really?
And Minnie Pearl has already been constructed, and it's absolutely amazing. I saw this on TV. It's so real. Have you ever been to a Madame Tussauds? I've been in France and also in England. They're
you have to get out of the country to do that, don't
well,
you?
Well, not anymore. Because it's
so
gonna,
I hadn't.
Be,
I hadn't been there.
It's going to be in Nashville.
And yeah, that's great.
I just think that's awesome. The work they do is yeah. whoever does.
Now
the,
is that that is that wax?
Yeah, it's like a wax museum.
Right.
And, but the detailing in her face, she looks so real. You know, if you come up on somebody in the night and you would just be convinced.
That reminds me, I had, she's back there behind the petitions right now, but I had Lori Morgan in my house for about a year, year and a half.
What happened to Lori?
She's back there.
Oh, she's still
she's back
okay.
there behind the petitions.
We lost Elvis, however, though. I
Elvis think. And Elvis got taken out and never brought back, and so did.
Elvis left the building.
So did.
Oh. Well,
we can't
I can't
think
remember.
Of it. We can't
oh, the kid with the fluffy hair and a cigarette and a white jacket.
James Dean.
James Dean.
Yeah. Somebody borrowed Elvis and James Dean and never brought them back. They
right.
thought they needed them more than we did.
Borrowers often are very disrespectful.
It's kind of a shame because we'd had both of them for years since we first started, actually.
Great.
And Lori Morgan was in my living room, and Fran finally said, get her out of my house.
Get her out of my life.
You know, well, she'd go walking in the middle of the night, go walking through the living room in the dark, and there'd be somebody standing in the corner, you know, and she'd forget that Lori was over there.
Yeah.
It's like the day I had Countryman in my car. I left Countryman on the front seat of my car, and it was early one morning. I went out to get something from the car, and I looked in the car, and there was this person sitting in there. It just scared the living daylights out of me. And it was Countryman. You knew remember who I'm talking
oh,
about.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Countryman's been on the show with us numerous times. He and Jimmy D are buddies.
There are people that put a mannequin like that in their car so they can drive the roadway, you know, where you
sure.
can only drive with a,
yeah.
two people. HOV.
Which is kind of clever.
Well, it's sort of like
sort of cheating, but
sort of like having stealing somebody's handicap pass and putting it in your car where you park
that's
in a handicap
really
slot.
I would never do that. I can't imagine.
But there are
that.
People who do.
I know.
You know, several years ago, and don't think bad of us for this, but because this is kind of the way it was until along with then. But we had slot machines at our club. And,
sure.
You know, and they weren't exactly legal, but
well, of course not.
You know, but
not in this state.
And right. And then one New Year's Eve, I remember there was some reason we thought we should take them out. And it was
got
kind of
a tip.
Yeah, and it was kind of a hurried situation, and so we split them up between some of the employees,
yeah.
and I had this Buick at that time, and I remember sitting three of them in the back seat of that Buick, you know, just and never covered them up or anything.
Just hauling them.
And we went ahead and did the New Year's Eve thing and such, and when it was over, one of my friends says, his car wouldn't start, so he asked me if he could borrow my car. I forgot the slot machines were in there. So he took my car, and I got it back two days later. He comes back with my car, and I'm looking at, I go outside, and there's these three slot machines still sitting up there in the back seat of that car, not covered up. I thought, I can't believe he's driving that car for 3 days with these slot machines in the back. It was probably so blatant that nobody would actually believe it.
What?
Yeah.
Surely that's not a slot machine.
Right.
Oh, my goodness.
Well, to get to something that you can turn it off now if you want to, because I'm going to ask Jimmy what he thinks about the national football playoff.
I'll doze off.
Selections.
I kind of thought Penn State might should have been in the top four. Other than that, you know.
Pretty much what it is.
Yeah, yeah.
Tennessee ended up, even with the troubles we had, ended up, what, 19 or 20?
Somewhere
22,
in,
something like
in
that.
In the top 25.
In the top 25, which is a good thing.
That's a good thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, you think Butch is safe for another year?
Oh, I definitely think he's safe for another year for a lot of reasons.
Yeah.
I think now Tennessee's paid off everybody that they fired in old money, too.
Oh, yeah, all the money.
which has a lot to do with it.
yeah, it does.
And plus, coaches these days, I think Butch Jones has about a $10 million payout. If they want to fire him, they got to pay him $10
million. Yeah, they're making big money.
Yeah. But some of them are even more than that. The guy they fired at LSU, Les Miles, I think his payout was something in the neighborhood of $15, $16 million. They had to pay Les. And then
to leave.
Yeah, and
don't you wish we'd pay
nice.
You? Would you leave if we could pay you $15 million?
And not that this would ever come into play, but Nick Saban, you know, I think his contract they renew it every year. He's always got 5 or 6 years left on it. But if they decided they wanted to fire Nick Saban, which they'd be crazy if they did, but they'd have to pay him almost $30 million.
Wow.
To fire him.
So
sounds like a president of a New York bank. That's what they have to pay to get rid of
him. Wouldn't you love a job like that?
Besides that, they probably. I know a lot of people. You may not have liked Coach Fulmer. We're going back to almost 10 years now.
Right.
You may not have liked Coach Fulmer, but the reality of the matter is he played in the Southeastern Conference Championship game in 2007, and I think he won 10-11 games that year. Had a tough year the next year, and they fired him. Well, it's been 10 years, and we ain't been back to the Southeastern Conference championship game.
I think we're all love Coach Fulmer.
Yeah, and you know, this is a guy that's won about 75% of his games over a 16-year career as a head coach. You know,
it's kind of sad that just all of a sudden, if you're winning, then all of a sudden you lost one time.
Well, it's because you're in the SEC and nobody can beat Saban. I mean, Les Miles had won 10 games for the last 5 years.
So had Mark Richt at Georgia.
At Georgia, couldn't beat Saban, so they fired him.
That's kind of sad.
Oh, whatever. Hey, I'll tell you what we're going to do right now is we're going to take a quick commercial break, and we'll be back with the rest of today's show. It's December. Christmas time is on the way. Christmas time's coming. Pay attention to the commercials. Go to some of our local businesses. Shop local. Don't drive out of town. Don't get on your computer to shop. First thing you do is check the businesses in town, shop local, and keep your money at home. We'll be right back.
To think about what I was physically before and what I am now, and I don't ever want to go back to that original situation.
The overall mission of the rehab team is always what is best for the patient and how we can facilitate maximum potential from every resident.
Well, the most important thing to me is that I'm allowed to do whatever I want to do, you know.
Everyday Miracles, Life Care Center of Tullahoma. Get your news first, fast, and free with your news leader on 6 every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday nights at 6, 8, and 10 p.m. Local weather, sports, community calendar events, and a comprehensive look at the latest news stories and newsmakers as only a video news broadcast can do. Get it first, fast, and free with News Leader on Channel 6, your local information network.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, and we're pleased to have joining us now from Shelbyville, Tennessee. To my left is Justin Hyde and also Susie Henderson. And Justin is with the Shelbyville Airport somewhere or other.
Yes, sir. Airport director. Then.
Which kind of ties in. And Susie just likes Christmas.
That's right.
Right.
And I'm just part of the Santa Claus.
Yeah, okay. But you, appropriately, because you're affiliated with the airport, you guys have got a neat thing happening here at Christmas. Tell us a little bit about it.
We actually have our second annual Santa fly-in that we are going to be doing this Saturday. December 10th, mm-hmm. at 1 o'clock. Until it'll go till about 4 o'clock. Santa lands, wheels down at 1 o'clock.
Okay.
So we encourage everyone to come out early and check it out. Be there, ready to see Santa land.
Where are y'all picking him up? Did you fly all the way to the North Pole?
Yeah, he has many stops around there, and so we have to go pick him up and bring him in.
Yeah, okay.
But, and the reason he's not using the reindeer is because, you know, reindeer are only magical on that special night.
Yeah.
So. We use aviation, and since he's the most famous aviator out there, we figure we'd bring him in his airplane.
So you're saying those reindeer can't fly except on Christmas,
yeah? That's the way I understand it.
Yeah, makes sense. Okay, yeah. All right. So you're going to fly him in what kind of airplane?
He's actually coming in a twin-engine aircraft that they'll be flying him in, and it is going to be decorated festive once he lands, and it has plenty of room for him to come out and bring all his future presents and toys, and there'll be candy canes for all and hot chocolate.
Okay. We better tell them what day that is.
It'll be December 10th, this Saturday.
This Saturday, okay.
December 10th.
Okay. So if this lasts from 1 to 4, there must be other things associated with this event.
This is what we've tried to do is allow plenty of time to bring the kids out. Last year we had over 300 kids, and there were 500 total, all the parents come out. And this opportunity lets kids be able to sit on Santa's lap and talk to him, figure out how they can tell them their Christmas wishes. And it gives the parents a unique opportunity to take the pictures with their own camera.
Yeah.
And that one, there's no charge, it's completely free.
Right.
And they're able to take the picture, put it on Facebook, take it to a local store and have it developed and be able to have that memento right there.
Yeah, okay. So.
We actually had some to say that they were going to use last year's picture was going to be this year's Christmas card.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because it was a chance that they had their whole families there at the same time.
Absolutely.
So do you get to sit on Santa's knee as well?
Yes, but usually they have me passing out hot chocolate.
Okay. Okay.
So, but I do take the opportunity to let Santa know what I want.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay. And you do as well, I'm
absolutely.
Sure.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, okay. And it's a great, like you said, a great opportunity to get the whole family in for a picture with Santa.
Yeah. So. Well, you know, it sounds like it. So is this an event that's pretty much taken care of entirely by the airport folks, or do you have other people working with you?
It is airport folks, volunteers, people who just care about aviation, want to help spread that joy. And like we said, Santa is the most famous aviator, and so it's a great way to be able to introduce him to the community and have the community be able to support the community in a way where we can have Santa be there for free.
Oh, okay. You can't beat that, Susie.
And it's sometimes the first time that a lot of the small kids have come to the airport and actually get a chance to see the airplanes and just to see what it's all about.
Uh-huh.
So it gives them a chance to check out the airport.
Sure. And I'm sure the adults might find that interesting as well, because I haven't been there in a while, but I have been there. But the Shelbyville is blessed to have a really nice airport, I believe.
We have a fantastic airport. Mr. Bomar, a staple in the community there, had started it up, and we've been doing some great projects that we've had. The taxiways are getting redone. The lighting is getting redone. Things that have been set in place many years ago are finally coming to fruition.
Uh-huh.
And so we're just excited to have all of that come together at this this point. And it's a great way to be able to show it to the community. A lot of the community from the area comes in.
Well, we host an EAA breakfast every fourth Saturday of each month. Uh-huh. And we have them come in from, we've had them come in as far away as from Birmingham to fly in. Atlanta, we've had a group to fly in out of Indiana, Kentucky, East, West Tennessee. I mean, they just come from all over. And we've been averaging this summer about 175 to come in, with about somewhere right around 65 airplanes each month. So that's a lot. And once we got our new ramp, we've been able to accommodate that. So it's just, it's been real nice.
You speak of the new ramp. What is that? Tell us.
It's basically the parking lot, you know, for the airplanes out there.
Right,
and
okay.
What we had was a large ramp, but it was aging, you know, and it was a little bit unlevel just from the terrain out there.
Uh-huh.
And so their past airport manager and past airport board were able to bring in a concrete ramp that's able to hold plenty of airplanes.
Okay. I'd have to think that having I know there's one here in Tullahoma, but that's got to be really important to your community, I would think. Industry, bringing in
it's
industry.
It's a great economic driver, and it is an off-ramp to the community just like any interstate would have. And business, when they fly into a community, generally they're not going to drive in, they're going to fly in, you know, because they need to be able to do their meetings, have their meetings, and continue on.
Mm-hmm.
And it's amazing, we get freight and air ambulance and all any type of aviation that could come in, the military are coming in, and then the tourists. Well, this is a great tourist area, and so we have people flying to here just as they fly into Tullahoma to come see the area, you know, and spend the weekend, spend their dollars, and continue on.
And they use the courtesy car, and they go over to some of our local, like Bell Buckle Cafe or Bocelli's.
Right, absolutely.
Some of our local Legends restaurants, they go in, just fly in, borrow the car, and go eat.
Absolutely.
Okay, great.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, well, it's nice that you guys are so hospitable about that.
And many airports are. And we encourage, you know, all the people here in Tullahoma, head out to see your local airport. You know, in Shelbyville and Bedford County, come see ours and just check out your local airport. There's a lot to offer.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So Mr. Bomar must have been a big-time visionary to have, I assume he was responsible for getting that airport there to begin with. Is that correct?
Yeah.
He actually built it. It's city owned now, but back then he started it, him and his wife. And he's actually in the Tennessee Aviation Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
So he did a whole lot to bring that into the community. He operated it for more than 50 years.
Yeah.
And it started out as a grass strip after he got out of World War II and started teaching people how to fly. Many people in Tennessee have learned how to fly because of Mr. Bomar.
Oh, I bet.
And he used to be the director of the Aeronautics Commission for Tennessee. He had a great handhold aviation for Tennessee.
I can only imagine that for Mr. Bomar, having been in World War II, that wasn't a big deal landing on a grass strip.
Yep.
because nobody's shooting at you.
That's right, exactly.
And that sort of thing.
Exactly.
What are the bigger aircrafts? How big of an aircraft can you guys handle there?
We get any of the corporate size jets, basically Lear jets, and going up to the Gulf Streams, we can handle all of those coming in.
Yeah.
And so the business that comes in where they offload 20 people to go in and do business within Bedford County and in the area, we are able to handle.
Okay. Well, let's rehash real quick, about out of time, but this Saturday, tell us.
December 10th at 1 o'clock, we'll have Santa flying in. He'll land at 1 o'clock, so we encourage everyone to come out a little bit early, and there will be plenty of time for everybody to be able to see Santa. There will be hot chocolate, candy canes given, and there will be Christmas music, Christmas cheer, and just a great time to be able to hang out, and the weather is looking like it will be great for it.
Okay. Maybe a little chilly, but it's going to be.
A little chilly, but
you know what?
That
sort of gets you in the Christmas spirit.
That's right.
I guarantee you that people won't mind that at all. Guys,
bring your own camera.
Thank you so much.
Thank
so
you.
So nice to meet you folks. Now, hope you'll be coming back to see us.
We will.
Y'all
Thank
a lot of fun. Folks, we'll be right back with more Living right after this.
Oh, hello, ladies and gentlemen. This is the paint. Uh-oh, I just knocked a tree over. This the paint doctor. I got the color wheel. Now, you know what a color wheel is? It is the wheel that the paint works where you pick all your colors to paint your room. It could be a multicolored beard. It could be a underarm fan. You never can tell. One thing we do know is that it's time to paint. You know, you can make your wife very happy if you go to your house and paint some rooms, or you paint the outside of the house, the inside of the house. It makes them feel very good because you work hard for them, and they like that. All women like to see their man sweat. You know, they do. Honeydew is what they do. And you get to do it, too. So you go to the paint works at 1960 North Washington Street, and you see Dabin Aikonen over there, and he's the real paint doctor. He fixes you up with color. It's so nice when the color is right. Go to Paint Works today, Martin Senor. See, Martin Senor, right there. Martin Senor out of the Paint Works. Bye, and we see you next time. I'm burning up.
You know what, guys? There's a lot of tree branches and dry brush over here. We should probably move the bonfire over there.
I'm guessing Smokey liked that idea.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. This past Friday night, before the rain started, we had the 60th annual Chamber of Commerce Christmas Parade right here in Tullahoma. And one of our favorite sons involving that, Billy Philpott, was the Grand Marshal this year. And we went to the tree lighting and reception for Billy at South Jackson Civic Center, and gonna bring you some video from that.
Ceremony. My name is Lane Curley, mayor of the town. At least everybody is here tonight. This has been a tough week in Tullahoma. We're a little bit bruised and battered, but we'll make it through. I think a real test of character, a community's character, is not how well they do when things are going well, but when things are a little bit tough. And it's been a tough week, and we've seen a lot of great character throughout the community this week. You know, the tornado was a tragedy and certainly impressive, but let me tell you what was even more impressive has been the volunteer turnout. So this is a special night. This is a chance to celebrate Christmas in Tullahoma, and for that we are very, very appreciative of this opportunity. And we're so appreciative of Stan McNabb family, and once again, helping to sponsor this parade. We appreciate the McNabb family and what they mean to our community. You know, it's also a special treat that we pause and we recognize and salute Billy Philpott for his work over the past several years in organizing this parade. Billy, we appreciate you and we're proud of you, and so we're very pleased to pause and recognize you for a job well done. So I'll turn it over to our retiring chamber director, Diane Bryan. And Diane, we also appreciate you very much and all that you've done for our community.
Thank you. Oh, thank you. And I will say this parade has always been just one of those great highlights of the year, every year. And this is our 60th annual, so we're so excited, and we're excited to have Billy Philpott as our Grand Marshal. And we'll talk a little bit more about it at the reception inside. But Billy the 60th is an important number for him for a lot of reasons, and we'll talk about that more when we're inside. But for right now, we want to thank all of y'all for being here. On now, we're here to go ahead and get this tree lit. So if we can have some help and get our Christmas tree lit to get the event started. Oh, yeah. Join us inside for the reception for Billy Philpott, our Grand Marshal, and then for all the rest of you that are in the transition period to go and to get into your cars and get into your floats, we're looking forward to seeing the parade, which will start right at 7 o'clock. Thank you for being here, and Merry Christmas!
Look at these good-looking girls right here, back here, getting, and look at that. Is that one of Santa's elves right there? Hello, how are you? I like your boots. Look at her boots. Aren't you pretty? And there's food on the table for this reception, and there's always in Tullahoma you can find something good to eat no matter where you go. And I think some of these pictures here on the that are around of Nutcrackers are the students of Annie Roan at the Painted House. And it makes for a festive appearance in the front room at South Jackson Civic Center. There's Mr. Philpott right there in front of the Christmas tree, our Grand Marshal. And look over here. Look how fortunate we are over here. There's Miss Tullahoma right there. Hi, sweetheart. How are you?
I'm good.
You look lovely tonight. You dressed to stay warm?
Yeah.
There you go. Good girl. Of course, there's Trey McNabb there, and his mom Jamie's over here. And Stan McNabb Auto Group has been sponsoring the Christmas parade for the last few years, and we appreciate them and all the work they do in our community.
We need a chamber president.
And there's the chamber president, Bill Yoder, and Stan McNabb, and the McNabb family, and Billy Philpott, and Diane, the chamber president, or chamber executive director. And it's the 60th annual Tullahoma Chamber of Commerce Christmas Parade.
Friday, December the 2nd, the 3rd annual Reindeer Fun Run will be held on Jackson Street in Tullahoma. This unique fun run and walk benefits the Tullahoma Animal Shelter. Cost for the Reindeer Fund is just a recommended minimum donation of $10, but anyone is welcome to join in the fun. Participants and walkers run down Jackson Street as the parade watchers gather. Runners are also encouraged to dress in their favorite Christmas flair. Pre-register at D.W. Wilson or on the day of the race at Fraser McEwen Park. Grab your antlers and join in the fun at the 3rd annual Reindeer Fun Run.
We get closer to a world with more birthdays when we take cancer patients by the hand. We help them find answers and guidance and hope and give them more candles to light. We're the American Cancer Society. Help create a world with more birthdays at morebirthdays.com.
Is this the year you want to get fit? If so, check out just some of the things Tullahoma Parks and Rec has to offer. Kickboxing, aerobics, silver sneakers workouts, swim lessons, boot camp, water aerobics, basketball, Zumba, yoga, pickleball, lap swimming, treadmill, karate. Get fit, Tullahoma, and have some fun with Tullahoma Parks and Rec.
When your family suffers the loss of a loved one, the caring and compassionate staff at Tullahoma Funeral Home and Coffee County Funeral Chapel are standing by to assist you in every way possible. We are proud to support local industry and offer only Batesville caskets. Many funeral homes don't own or operate a crematory. We utilize the only crematory in Coffee County. Your loved one never leaves Coffee County. We can accommodate any need and any budget. Consider our complete pre-need service to remove this burden from your family during their time of grief. Lock in today's low costs and protect from inflation. Tullahoma Funeral Home and Coffee County Funeral Chapel. Our family caring for your family.
Thank you.
Hollywood. I'm John Rickman.
And this is Pat Welch. And John, we're here for the Conversations of John and Pat segment 36.
I want to do a song for you, Pat.
All right.
This is one that people remember. I think it was recorded by the Kingston Trio in 1958. It's called Tom Dooley.
Oh, yeah.
Very good song.
Yeah. And Kingston Trio was really good folk singers that I can, I've YouTubed them a couple times and just got very,
you know,
going back to the 60s.
All songs do not have to be complicated. Now, if you folks out there want to look at my fingers playing the chords, it's only two chords in this song.
It's musically illiterate, think I am, John. That's a capo you got above those fingers, isn't it?
That's right. There have been many songs written about the eternal triangle. This one tells of a Mr. Grayson, a beautiful woman, and a man named Tom Dooley. When the sun rises tomorrow, Tom Dooley must die. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley. Hang down your head and cry. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley. Poor boy, you're bound to die. I met her on the mountain. There I took her life. I met her on the mountain. Stabbed her with my knife. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley. Hang down your head and cry. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley. Poor boy, you're bound to die. This time tomorrow, reckon where I'll be. Hadn't have been for Grayson, I'd been in Tennessee. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley. Hang down your head and cry. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley. Poor boy, you're bound to die. This time tomorrow, reckon where I'll be. Down in some lonesome valley, hanging from a white oak tree. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley. Hang down your head and cry now, boy. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley. Poor boy, you're bound to die. Poor boy, you're bound to die.
Wow, John. That
1958.
I thought that was comparable.
I was young.
The Kingston Trio, but the introduction was far superior.
Well, thank you, Pat. Yeah. I doubt that, but you know.
No, I'm just playing lip service here.
We're going to show several pictures today of a letter that my daddy. We had a secretary, an old secretary, which is the same thing as a desk, up in our front room at Chapel Hill. And there were letters in there. I remember these letters laying there. Nobody ever bothered them. And they had been passed down from my great-great-grandmother's sister, I think. I think that's the way it came. But one of the letters, I'll let Philip, if he will, put that letter up. This letter was one of those. And it's very fluid writing. And it was to Colonel Aaron Boyd. He calls him General Boyd. That's flattery, I guess, but really Colonel Boyd was the proper ranking, whatever that part now, of service
was. Who's writing the letter?
A fellow named Edward Zane Carroll Judson. We didn't know this in the beginning. This is what's really fantastic. Sometimes these letters can be there and you don't know who they are from. Well, it was from E.Z.C.J. or Edward Z.C. Judson. And there's a fellow north of Chapel Hill
who is a historian, and I showed him the letter, and he said, you know, I think I know who that is. And we're going to tell him in just a minute. And let me read the letter. Go ahead, and maybe you can see that on the TV screen. This is written from the Franklin House nearly a year ago. Dear sir, I promised you a likeness that was given me by your son, drawn by his own hand from a looking glass. They didn't call mirrors the looking glass before him. I just have just found the picture and hastened to send it to you, enclosing it through your kind friend, Mr. Eli S. Wood of Nashville. Take it, my dear sir, as a memorial of your noble son, whom I dearly love dearly, and when you look upon it, I pray you sometimes think of me as one who has seen some hard knocks in this world and who has been sinned against more than sinning. That's sort of interesting. But you can tell whoever wrote this was a well-written person, and the cursive writing that he learned used was so nice. It was written from the Franklin House in but it has no date on it. But this young man...
Do you know where the Franklin House is?
Well, either Philadelphia or New York, I think. I was told this not too long ago. I found out that was maybe the place. Show the picture of the young man that had... That's a picture of Joseph Britton Boyd, probably some distant kin to Harry Britton. I don't know. Maybe. I've always thought that. Anyway,
but
they lived above. They lived. It'll pull somebody else into the legend.
That's right.
But anyway, that was a picture of him. Now, Philip, show the last picture. This was Edward Zane Carroll Judson, alias Ned Buntline. On the left, you see that's Ned Buntline along with Buffalo Bill Cody and Texas Jack. Let me tell you a little bit about Edward Zane Carroll Judson. He was a ruffian. He was an entrepreneur. He was the first person to put out, as I understand, dime Western novels in the West. And some of them were written about Buffalo Bill. And then later on, he would produce Buffalo Bill in some of his stage shows.
Huh.
So this is a very interesting letter from a man that my wife and I drove there not too long ago to Cody, Wyoming, and there we went to the Buffalo Bill Museum. I took the letter that you saw in the beginning to the curators, and they were carried away about
that. That's great.
It was. It's a good letter, and I would like to challenge anyone out there that might have old letters in your files. You can never know where they're from. Another little thing about Ned Buntline.
John, how do you spell that last name?
Buntline?
Mm-hmm.
Buntline. You thought you could trick me, didn't you?
No, I knew you could spell it. I just wanted to be sure I was hearing correctly there.
But on the old Wyatt Earp show, I don't know if you remember that. It was a serial show back in the 50s, early 60s.
Do I remember it? Keep going. I've got a
great story. He had a Buntline special, and that was told that Ned Buntline made these large guns and gave them to certain people, one being Wyatt Earp.
John, I'm going to follow through with a not as historical, but you mentioned that TV show, and you're the first one that I've ever talked to or heard speak of that show. But they had a commercial when I was about 5 years old, and Wyatt had taken a villain and tied his feet and raised him up to some barn rafters and had him eye level upside down. And he put a gun to his head and he said, so-and-so, I'm going to make you speak upside down or I'm going to turn you inside out. Well, me and my brother had been about four, and the next one had been about three. We thought that was the greatest cowboy scene we had ever seen. And my mother took a nap in the afternoon normally, and we snuck outside when we were supposed to be sleeping and took every toy we had, tricycle, metal cars that you'd pedal, anything, and stacked them up. And I climbed that tower to the first branch, and we tied a rope to my feet and tied it to that branch. And then my brothers pulled the lower toys out, and I went straight down. And they pulled out a cap gun, and for about 5 minutes told me that I was going to speak upside down or they're going to turn me inside out.
That's why the media needs to be real careful about what you present.
Correct. And well,
and it's time to go, Pat.
After about 5 minutes, the blood came to my head. My mother was up from the nap, and I saw her upside down through the kitchen window in her eyes. She came out with a butcher knife, and that was the start of my neck problems because she cut me down in one swipe. And your statement is correct. The media needs to be careful about what they project.
And we need to be careful about what we say.
That is correct. That is correct.
And maybe they'll have us back.
And I don't know if my mother ever recovered from finding her son hanging upside down in a tree.
All right, let's sign off.
Hey, we need to sign off, John. That was segment 36, but that's not the end of our stories. No. We've got lots of conversations to go. Thank you.
Smoking tobacco accounts for 3 of every 10 fire deaths in the United States.
Tullahoma Fire Department, Tullahoma Fire Department, need you en route to a structure fire, 202 Main Street, heavy smoke showing. Neighbors advise child trapped inside.
Lighters, matches, and associated smoking paraphernalia are the leading cause of preschooler fire deaths. We as firefighters know that most structure fires can be prevented.
I've got one.
Command, this is primary search. We have a victim. Need EMS to meet us at the front door. Oh,
no. Please help us to give you a fighting chance. This can be prevented. Contact the Tullahoma Fire Department for a free home safety inspection.
What's a Tennessee vacation? It starts off like any road trip, and then, boom, adventure and thrills everywhere you look, which happens to be some of the most beautiful scenery in the country. Music here, history there, and all kinds of green in between. Come relax and unwind, or bring the crowd for some stargazing, or stargazing. Whatever you do, come hungry and expect an awesome soundtrack. It's all right here in Tennessee. We're playing your song. For a free vacation guide, visit tnvacation.com.
Get your news first, fast, and free with your news leader on 6 every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday nights at 6, 8, and 10 p.m. Local weather, sports, community calendar events, and a comprehensive look at the latest news stories and newsmakers as only a video news broadcast can do. Get it first, fast, and free with News Leader on Channel 6, your local information network.
Welcome back. We have this wonderful tribute band coming into South Jackson on the 16th, which is a week from Friday. And for tickets, it's 455-5321. And we're going to show a little excerpt of Chris Collins, who is tributing John Denver and his Boulder Canyon Band. That's...
Almost heaven. West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountain, Shenandoah River. Life is old there, older than the trees, younger than the mountains, growing like a breeze. Country roads take me home to the place I belong. West Virginia. Water. and dusty, painted on the sky. Misty taste of moonshine, teardrops in my eye. Country roads take me home to the place I belong. West Virginia, Mount Mama, take me home, country roads.
Time for every family and business in Tullahoma to go green and recycle. Tullahoma Public Works makes it simple and easy to recycle. Just place your recyclable materials, paper, plastic, aluminum, and cardboard, beside your garbage container on the same day your garbage is picked up. Your recycled materials don't have to be in a fancy container. Recycling is not only the right thing to do, it makes sense. Recycling pays. Paying to bury our garbage costs each of us. Please do your part. Let's go green, Tullahoma, and recycle.
Hi, I'm Cindy.
And I'm Jacob.
I'm the Rooster.
And I'm the Red Maid. And we would like to welcome you to
Roosterware.
Yes, Roosterware is a cottage industry producing accessories for men, women, children, babies, and pets. All items are hand-cut and sewn locally. Roosterware specializes in bow ties, pocket squares, scarves, cufflinks, neckties, and aprons of all sizes for all ages. Baby products include onesies, diaper covers, bibs, and burp pads. All bow ties, tie-it-yourself or pre-tied, come with an adjustable neckband. All products can be made with a material of your choice, as special orders are available upon request. Don't be standing back looking at fashion. Create your own with Roosterware.
Come visit us at
roosterandredmaiden.com
to find our handcrafted designs for
the cock of the walk.
Everybody has a dream. Mine was to see the ocean. And with a little help, I made it.
Get your news first, fast, and free with your news leader on 6 every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday nights at 6, 8, and 10 p.m. Local weather, sports, community calendar events, and a comprehensive look at the latest news stories and newsmakers as only a video news broadcast can do. Get it first, fast, and free with News Leader on Channel 6, your local information network.
All right, folks, we're back, and you know, we talked earlier in the show today about last week was the Christmas Parade 60th annual, and had some video on Billy Philpott, and now we have Diane and Bill here with us. Diane is the executive director, and Bill Yoder's the president of the Chamber of Commerce right now, and the parade is over, but the holiday season is just beginning. and we have some great things that they want to talk about to get you involved in spending your money at home, which is a very important thing to do.
Diane?
Well, it's called Shop Local. Imagine that. And I think anywhere you go around this town, each Friday between now and Christmas, you see all of the Shop Local Tullahoma t-shirts, and everybody's proudly wearing those. And we are reminding everyone that it's how important it is to spend your money in our local community. So the exchange had a very great idea that they had experimented with in the Fayetteville market last year. And we decided to take it to kind of the next level. So we had 22 sponsors step up to be a part of this campaign, which included t-shirts, and it included contributing $100 toward these weekly drawings that we are doing. So everyone that goes out into the local community, they need to bring their receipts of where they've spent their money locally to the chamber, then they'll put their name and their phone number or their name and their email on there, and then they put it into, actually it's grown to a big bag. I think we're going to get a Santa's bag to do the final drawing,
to be very honest,
because it is cumulative. So once you go in there, you stay in there till you're drawn out. And each Friday, we are drawing three winners, and no matter what the amount is on that receipt, each of those winners gets $200. So last Friday, we gave away $600 to three Tullahoma. Well, actually, you don't even have to be a Tullahoma resident, but it just happened it was three residents of Tullahoma. So, and we will do that this Friday. We will do it every Friday up until Christmas Eve. So the good part is you get out and you spend your money local, and we've been very open with this. It doesn't matter, you know, if it really can cover anything, everything, except probably your utility bill.
Right.
So I mean, if it's an Aldi, you know, last week Aldi's, it was Aldi receipt, an Iron Gate receipt, and I can't remember what the third receipt was. So it's a good mix of a lot of the small businesses, but it also includes the national brands as well, because that's still tax money that's going into our community.
Right. But Shop Small is always my Shop Local. Yes.
Yes.
But I tag also Shop Small.
Absolutely.
On that. Because, you know, yes, Aldi's is tax dollars here, but profit leaves town. Small businesses, the profit is spent at home. It's not going to Atlanta, or it's not going to wherever the home office is for this big corporation.
It's a small locally owned store. Which is true, but your franchises are also, you know, locally owned.
Some of them are.
I think that's one of the main reasons that we've tried to do.
Yeah, but it's shop small, shop local. Local first and small if you can.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that's one of the reasons with turning the receipts into the chamber office downtown, I think it's really anybody that goes in any of our local small shops immediately just comes by the chamber office and turns them in.
Yeah, that's great.
So that's worked out really great.
And it's you know, it's just we're so fortunate and we're not fortunate that we had a tornado, but we're fortunate that we have the town that we do that's responded to that the way it has. And I'm impressed, very impressed, have been over the last 6 or 8 years in our young people who are becoming involved in our community.
And we are too.
And the way they're taking leadership roles, not just in business, but in soft things that happen around the community, the cultural side of our community and everything like that. And I know the Chamber's been very involved in getting these young people to become engaged, not only with the Chamber, but with our community as a whole.
And to empower them
to
volunteer and to empower them to sit on boards and to get involved at that leadership level.
Right.
And Bill, as our 2016 president, and then going into next year as well, is continued to oversee our Emerging Leaders program. But this year, we decided to take it to a new level, and Southern Community Bank stepped up to be the supporting sponsor, and we had an MVP awards last Tuesday.
Who brought home the hardware?
Well, Diane will tell you that in a minute, but certainly it's a program we've been talking about doing for quite some time and really made the decision to make it happen this year, and so excited about that, and had 20 people that were nominated to win an MVP award. So there's so much good things happening with our younger generation here, and it was very heartening to see read those nominations.
Right, right.
So our Elite Five.
Elite Five.
Elite Five.
All right.
The first is Chelsea, in no specific order,
right.
but Chelsea Dockety with Lester Green and McCord has been, over the entire past 12 years that I can remember, whether she was an ambassador for the chamber, whether she was coordinating the PTO for her daughter over at the high school, whether she was working with the Distinguished Young Women's campaign that is ongoing, and all the work that several of the people in our community do in that regard. She has been passionate about our Shop Local and Shop Small campaigns and has really encouraged the chamber to stay active, and has led that activity at the chamber and is on our board of directors. And we just felt that she represented so many of the things that all rolled into one. And then another one of our recipients was Hank Durden of Southern Community Bank. And Hank has been here 4 years. And in that 4 years, not only is doing a great job for his employer, but also, has gotten very involved in the community in respects to Five Loaves for Kids. I think he has been extremely active in our Tullahoma Noon Rotary. And as a lot of people know, in Rotary, it's not just a one-year commitment. You have to go through all the steps, and you have to serve in every role and move forward on that. And his leadership has not gone unnoticed. And he's one that he might not be. He's there. He's a part of the team. He has good ideas. And a lot of that is what makes these leadership roles the ones.
Now, he also is working very hard to keep the balance in the redhead population.
Oh, okay, good. Okay, that was something that was not brought out, so I appreciate you.
You have to have the right amount of redheads in the mix, or the community just doesn't work properly.
I love it. And then another one of our recipients was Hope Sarton, and Hope has been very, very active in the community. She works, obviously with the Exchange Media Group, by day, and then by night, she's been very, very involved with the chamber, with the Kiwanis. Once again, been a part of taking some very, thought out ideas and then turning them into action with the 41A Music Festival.
Right.
And then obviously she has done very similar things, being Ambassador of the Year twice with the Chamber Program. So her area of volunteer has taken her now to even where she is, on our executive board as well. So we're just very proud of Hope, and she is one of those that wants to learn and will take every advantage to try to improve herself, and that is a big part of leadership as well.
She dances well, too.
And she dances well. And on that note, Kelly Pierce was another one of our recipients.
She dances well
since
as well.
She has volunteered and danced with the Michael Jackson team, if you will, which puts in a whole lot of hours of practice as well as volunteerism, if you will. But Kelly is one of those examples of someone who has taken her position in volunteering with the chamber and in the years that she worked at the chamber, and has gone out and taken those contacts and really shown how, by getting involved, you can grow your business.
Sure.
And not only has she grown one business, which is, obviously in the hairstyling area, to be very successful at Creations Hair Salon, but also she is bringing Kidsville News back into circulation and stronger than ever.
Good.
So she is using those contacts to really help her grow two businesses that are very impactful for our community. And then our last recipient was Brian McAdams with the Tullahoma Funeral Home. And he is another person that has come in and not only, made a big impact from his business as far as trying to redefine their scope and really reconnect themselves into the community. But also, he has done a lot of volunteer work, that a lot of it goes on behind the scenes, but then he has also stepped up a lot with the chamber in respects to really taking leadership roles straight out of the gate.
He's one of those guys, you know, there's certain people that live in a community forever and certain people that move in and react like they've been here forever, mm-hmm. and light it up. Mm-hmm. He came in this town and he just lit it up.
Yep. Yeah,
and from day one, you could see that this guy was going to be special.
Yep.
In how he reacted and communicated with the town and the people and the businesses and stuff. Great guy.
Yep. Yep.
Really good guy.
Yep. So we're extremely proud of this group and had a great luncheon, probably Lakewood's last for a while, since it was that Tuesday.
Yeah, I'd say so.
So anyway, we had a great luncheon and a great celebration, and like you say, 20 of our 25 to 40-year-olds were nominated.
Very good.
And then, very strong pool.
Yes, very and good. We're looking
very
forward
good.
To growing this again.
Congratulations.
Yeah. And then our last thing is, we are gearing up for the celebration, and that will be January 28th, okay. which is it's the fourth Saturday in January.
Okay.
So we will be celebrating on that date everything that has gone on in 2016. So we're looking for nominations for Citizen of the Year.
Okay.
So we need to, obviously, that is a strong pull there, and so the committee needs a lot of time to be able to go through that. So we have set the deadline. We need those entries by January the 13th. So that is the...
When are you retiring?
When am I retiring? Yeah. I'm retiring the 31st of December.
All right, January the 1st, I'll nominate you for Citizen of the Year. Because you won't be working there anymore.
Oh, here we go. Well, I am planning on giving out that award. I will say that. I have been asked to, as my last hurrah, to present the awards that night.
Okay.
So I do plan to do that. So anyway, but thank you for the compliment.
Right. But people, if people want to do that and send a name in or do that, they need to do it now.
Yes.
I would assume they can make reservations. You have tables that can,
yes.
Absolutely.
Companies can take a whole table.
Yes.
And
accepting
and get,
door prizes and,
right,
and
yes, auction items.
Auction items and all that stuff. Usual stuff.
All of that's in full gear, and we've got some good ideas in respects to the tables, because we really want to get some more acknowledgement to, like, the shop local. So we're going to reach out to all of our small businesses and see if they would like to buy individual tickets and sit at a shop local table.
Okay.
We're trying to do the same thing with the nonprofits, where you would have a nonprofit table and let them buy tickets and then be able to sit together. The suggestion was to do, like, the Coffee County Bar Association. So we're really trying to grow that and develop that table concept, and that is a new
very
idea
good.
We're working on this year.
So can I put my coconut bra up or what?
You know, yes,
what
because we're doing Mardi Gras.
Oh, all right. I got beads, baby. Hey.
Yes. Oh, here we go. No.
Let's see. Coconut bra and Mardi Gras.
That's right. Here we go. And we've had a volunteer step up that has about 400 pounds of Mardi Gras beads in their basement. So we're going to have...
how many times they've been.
We're going to have lots of beads. That's right.
We got to get out of here. They're telling us we need to do something else right now, I guess. But thank you so much for all the information. It's great for y'all to come. It's always fun. And, you know, what am I going to do if the next executive director is not a chick? How can I have a chamber chick with no chick?
You know, you're just going to have to wait and see, like all the rest of us.
Okay.
The chamber rooster?
Oh, Lord have mercy.
Could be.
I think it's time to go.
Time to go. Folks, we'll be right back after these messages.
animal shelter has served Tullahoma dogs for nearly 30 years. Now, you can help us build a bigger and better no-kill shelter. Your tax-deductible gift is matched dollar for dollar. So come on, bark it forward and donate now to have your tax-deductible gift matched. Make your check payable to the COT Shelter Building Fund and go to tullahomatn.gov to see all the unique gifts available for your generosity. For more details, you can call City Hall at 455-2648.
Did you take your medicine?
Oh, gosh, I forgot it.
Her nurse.
You need a claim number?
Her personal assistant.
Let me just grab a...
Her housekeeper. Her cook. Her accountant. When I started taking care of Mom, I didn't realize the challenge of playing so many roles. But above all, I'm still her daughter.
Visit aarp.org/caregiving to connect with experts and other caregivers. Together, we can better care for ourselves and the ones we love.
Good morning there. Thanks, John. Good to see everybody. You and TV Land, we're glad that y'all are seeing us too. Thank you, camera ladies. Good to see y'all. Couldn't do it without y'all. And hello, Dot, and hello, Justine, and hello all our good viewers and listeners that have said they like this segment of the show. We'd love to share it with you. Let me ask you to go back in time. Not too far back, but about 1940, this time of year in 1940, 60 years ago, the war clouds were rumbling and it looked like that good old U.S. of May might be involved in some wartime activities, and the authorities that, powers that might be, selected their selections of training camps for Army and Navy and Air Force, selected Tullahoma to be a training ground for the Army because the terrain around here was much like that in Luxembourg and France and Germany. And of course, even before 1940, Tullahoma had always been a training ground for military people. Like in 1926, Governor Austin P. established a National Guard Training Center in East Tullahoma, where the Tennessee National Guard came every Sunday for every summer for a two-week training from all over the state, and they trained at Camp P. Most of it was infantry, but even before that, from January of 1863 to July of 1863, General Braxton Bragg had some 25,000 troops in Tullahoma and Manchester and Shelville, having retreated from the Battle of Stones River in Murfreesboro. So Tullahoma and the surrounding area have been for many, many years the center of training activities for the armed forces. Now, back in 1940, it was determined that they were going to build a big Army training center in Tullahoma. That decision was made in September of 1940, and construction began in late October of 1940. And Governor Prentice Cooper named this Army training base Camp Forrest in honor of our great Southern Cavalry leader, General Nathan Bedford Forrest from Memphis, that was a great leader during that time of the Civil War, and rightly so, because he was such a great, great leader. And Tullahoma, a sleepy little town of 3,000 or 3,500 people in September of 1940, grew almost overnight to 15,000 to 20,000. The workers came in from all over the southeastern United States, seeking jobs for the construction of the camp. They They slept in cars, they slept in trucks, they slept in tents, they slept in attics, garages, barns, wherever they could find a place to rest their head. And to get a job, they had to belong to the Carpenters Union, whose headquarters was in the back of a grocery store on Wall Street in Tullahoma. And they'd go to sign up to get a job as a carpenter, and the union officials asked them, where are your tools? And they said, well, don't they furnish tools out there where they're building? They said, no, you got to go get some tools. So Lawson's Hardware was just two doors from there, and those seeking membership in the union would go up to Lawson's and buy a hammer or a yardstick or a pound of nails or something related to construction, and go back down and they'd sign them up in the Carpenters Union. They all those construction workers and truck drivers and lumber people worked around the clock for months and months and months. That winter was one of the worst winters that was ever took place in this area. It was either mud one day or dust the next. It was just horrible. But they've got gravel to try to lay some roads out there where they could get to the construction site. And those big old international dump trucks got gravel from the quarry at Normandy and Lynchburg and Hillsboro. And again, they worked around the clock to get that material down there. Well, the first troops moved in late February of 1941. The 181st and 191st Field Artillery moved in, and they were from Middle Tennessee. And then in March, the Illinois National Guard was federalized, the 33rd Division, and they moved in March of 1941, some 25,000 of them. And they went on maneuvers, and the picture that you see now is Gate 1. I made this picture in 1941, and it's straight now, I think. Can you see it? I hope you can. I delivered papers out there and delivered groceries out there, and I was waiting to get in the gate at that time. And while I was waiting, I stuck my little camera out the truck window and made this picture. It's the only picture I've ever seen of Gate 1. It's been used by hundreds of people, and put on a postcard, and it's that guard that you see in the picture happened to come by a few months ago and said, you know that picture you made of Gate 1 in 1941? I said, yeah. Well, he said, I'm the guard that was standing there directing people in, and I had remembered his face, but I didn't know his name. And he was also head of the military police headquarters next to the city hall up at the corner of Lincoln and Atlantic Street when the camp was here. Nice fella. And people come every month or so to visit or show their grandchildren where daddy served and our granddaddy served his basic training at Camp Parson. A very interesting place. It existed from 1941 when it was built until 1946 when they raised it, and you can only see footings and foundations of some of the buildings out there now. But it was a great place, and we really enjoyed meeting a lot of nice people from all over the country. One lady came by a year or so ago and said, do you remember where the hospital was? I said, yes. And she said, well, my father was in the 168th Field Artillery from Colorado, and my mother was expecting me, and he brought her with him when they came to the Camp Forest, and I was the first baby born at the hospital there at Camp Forest. Very attractive lady. She said if they ever have a reunion or a gathering, I'd love to come and be part of it. But we made a lot of friends through the years, and it's been real fun. Would you believe that when Camp Forest was announced, there were two taxi cabs in Tullahoma and Manchester combined, and at the height of the camp, there were 886 taxi cabs in Coffee County, and they stayed busy all the time. The troops got out on Friday afternoon at 4 o'clock for a weekend and had to be back on the base by midnight Sunday night. And you can imagine when those special trains came in and brought them back, what a fight it was for a taxi cab. But it was a whole lot of fun, and you know, there was a patriotism and Americanism, a loyalty and a cooperative effort because of wartime that we haven't seen since then. And everybody enjoyed it and cooperated for the war effort. And let me tell you, there's a whole lot more to come. This is not the end of the story, and I'll be looking forward to sharing some more with you. And until then, you have a good day.
First, fast, and free with your news leader on 6 every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday nights at 6, 8, and 10 p.m. Local weather, sports, community calendar events, and a comprehensive look at the latest news stories and newsmakers as only a video news broadcast can do. Get it first, fast, and free with news leader on Channel 6, your local information network.
So fast.
Peggy,
what?
I heard that you wanted to talk about big old butts.
Yes, I want to talk about Boston butts.
Oh, Boston. Oh.
We have Boston butts for sale at South Jackson Civic Center. Great Christmas gifts, just like a ticket to John Denver.
That's right.
It's a great Christmas
right,
gift. We gotta go.
Okay. See you next time with a really big show.
There absolutely is, and what a great guy he is.
Yes, you know that Billy was the president of his senior class and the king of his senior class in 1956.
And I'd like to wish everyone a Merry Christmas.
Ooh. The Tullahoma Middle School
band.
Yes. Oh, I bet they'll play us a Christmas tune. What do you bet?
They probably will.
There are 130 7th and 8th graders in the band from East and West.
You know, and Candy, this is the first time they've played together as a group. They practice separately, and then they bring all four classes together to do this Christmas parade.
Tullahoma has a lot of good music, a lot of good leadership.
Absolutely, and I think they're going to be doing a concert this week. It's December 11th.
Okay, at the high school, I believe.
Yeah.
Oh, they're going to play a little Christmas tune for us.
Yeah.
McFarland, you know, he's one of Tullahoma's own.
Yeah.
Came back to direct the band. It was the CFC recycling entry. And I believe they're carrying the Tullahoma Middle School cheerleaders. They're pretty bundled up, but I bet they're good for a good cheer.
I bet they are, too.
There we go. Oh, they're excited. There we go. Yay!
Yeah.
This is our Miss Tullahoma, Alexis Cornelius, and she is the reigning Miss Tullahoma. It's been driven by her parents, Stephanie and Robin Cornelius, and her vehicle is being provided by Stan McNabb.
Yeah.
She is such a beautiful girl. And now we have little Miss Tullahoma, Marley Chesser. And Marley is the daughter of Ross and Rachel Chesser and is a second grader at Robert Lee Elementary School. She enjoys soccer, dance, cheerleading, and gymnastics. Says when she grows up, she'd like to be a veterinarian.
Look, you're looking now at the Distinguished Young Woman of the Tullahoma and Cumberland Valley for this year. That's Kimberly Noe
and Zoe Carter.
Yes,
aren't they beautiful girls? It's a national scholarship program for junior girls across the United States. That's the Robert E. Lee Energy Team. I bet they have a lot of energy. What do you bet?
I bet they do, too. And you know, they like to educate themselves about reducing and reusing and recycling. Molly, that's your Mullins Football League champions for 2016. It must be the Yellow Jackets. This is the Resource MFG entry in tonight's parade. They're making the holidays brighter for hundreds of families this year.
160 students. Now that's a wonderful crowd
of
folks.
Yes, it is.
And they've had another award-winning season. I think they have one every year.
They do, and you know, what a great ambassadors they are to our community because they excel wherever they go.
And people look forward to hearing our band, and you know, I believe they're going to be going to Hawaii next year, isn't that
they
right?
They are. I think early part of 2017, they are going to be going to Hawaii, and that's the first time they've been there in about 25 years, I think. So.
Wow, aloha.
So they're also going to be doing a concert this December the 11th, a holiday concert at 2 o'clock at the high school auditorium. Look, there's Martin McFarland. How did he get back here?
It's 60 years of magic. He's so good. And he's not even 60.
I'm telling you.
I've often wondered how the directors march backwards.
This is their float, actually, that won that candy coming into view right now.
Oh, how beautiful. Put a lot of work into that, didn't they?
Oh,
wow.
You know they did, yes.
It's beautiful.
Who's going to be your Chick-fil-A entry tonight? They've kind of tried to, oh, look at this, you know. They've got back in the theme of the 60s here with those poodle skirts and skates. Can you roller skate, Candy?
I used to.
You used to.
That's one of those things.
Yeah.
I sure enjoyed it when I could do it.
This is your entry from First Baptist Church in Tullahoma, a night in Bethlehem.
And I believe there's Mr. George Stuckey driving that truck. There he is.
It's hard to imagine it's been that long.
That's
this is Girl
want.
Scout Troop number 312 coming into your screen. 312, Girl Scout Troop 312 is led by Sherry Turner Antrus and assisted by Denise Sutton and Samantha Rivera. 24 girls in that troop, ranging from first grade to sixth grade. Middleton Sea Corvette Club. And that's Danny and Deborah Lamb, I believe, in the red car there. Ken and Connie Tyson was on the other side there.
Tenova Healthcare Heart and Tenova Medical Group. Look at that wagon.
Yeah, that
wow.
is so good.
That's the biggest wagon I've ever
yeah,
seen, I do believe.
And this is what the kids have been waiting for all night, ladies and gentlemen. Santa Claus.
I love
it even
Santa Claus.
Candy's even getting excited as well about Santa